and tigers and bears, oh my! Or should I say, gators, ducks, and bunnies, oh my! Some students around the school have gone far beyond the common cat and dog and opened their homes to some more interesting animals. We found out the best and worst things about owning these animals.
Hayden, I know that you recently got a pet. What kind of pet did you get?
I got a Japanese moss ball. Its name is Oliver. That was just decided a couple seconds ago.
And how did you decide to get a pet of this nature?
So I didn't want to be able to actually kill something, so I thought a ball of moss would be more fitting for my level. I don't have to do anything. Every once in a while I just have to stir the water so it doesn't become flat. But other than that, don't feed it.
I have Polish top hats, chickens, so they're essentially chickens with afros, pretty much.
And do they have any sort of special significance?
They're really nice showbirds, so I showed them in 4-H.
And what's the hardest thing about owning this kind of pet?
Keeping them clean. They like to, you know, take the mud baths or whatever, so their top hats are constantly matted and dirty.
I have 3 red-tailed boas, a desert king snake, and an American alligator.
How do you take care of these kinds of pets?
The snakes are pretty simple. You feed them and clean their cage once a week because that's all they eat. The alligator you have to feed every day because that's how they normally run the wild. Have to clean them every day. Have to just stay up on the filtration system because it's an alligator. They're very messy. And you have to make sure you train them properly. My favorite memory is probably picking up my baby red-tailed boa Lucy. She was my favorite, or my first snake I got myself and paid for. She is a hypo red-tailed boa, and she is, to me, one of the most stunning animals I own.
I have a miniature donkey, Dominic, named after the Italian Christmas donkey song. We have had Dominic for about a year and a half now. We originally got him to be a companion for our horses, but he ended up being more of a pet. He loves to play chase in the backyard and enjoys affection and treats. He's been a great pet and we have had lots of laughs with him.
My exotic pet, well, I kind of have a mini farm. I have chickens and dogs and cats and a rabbit and a duck.
Oh my goodness, do you have a...
Goats too.
Goats too. So what are the, do you know the names of your animals?
Yes. You want me to name them all?
Name your favorites.
Oh, well, my favorites are my dogs, but... do you want to hear about a duck I have?
Yes.
Her name is Daphne. Oh. I did have another duck named Daisy, but she was attacked. She survived the attack, but eventually died, I think, of shock.
I'm sorry. So do you have a favorite memory from your ducks?
Daphne and Daisy, too, when she was younger. They love water. You know, everybody knows that. And the ducks, like when it snows outside, she's super, super happy. When it rains, she's happy. She's just talking all the time. Probably, though, the first time I got out of a baby pool and filled it with water, and she was just, they were both so excited to get in and swim and talk about it and everything.
Thank you so much. Thanks for sharing.
Thank you.
Sanders isn't the only one who needs mittens. Winter for some means cold weather and icy roads, but for some students at Delta, it means getting out and shredding the ski slopes. While there's not many slopes in Indiana, Northern Michigan is a popular destination for this activity.
I got into skiing because my parents have been skiing pretty much their entire lives, so it was something that we've done as a family, which is pretty cool. My favorite memory from a skiing trip, probably when we go night skiing. It's a lot of fun. It's dark, but the lights are on, so... And there's not a lot of people, so it's pretty chill. Usually we go to Boyne Mountain or Boyne Highland. It's up in northern Michigan.
My favorite memory probably was when I was in elementary school. One time all my cousins thought it would be fun to go skiing in their swimsuits, so they did that one day when it was like 40 degrees or something.
Tell us about your Instagram account.
So when I was in like elementary school, for some reason I thought it would be kind of cute or quirky to make my Instagram account Ski Mary Ski. It's not still active, but I don't know why I did that. I just thought it was fun, I guess.
One of my favorite memories was going to Vermont and skiing out there. It's a lot different. The hills are bigger, and so it was a lot of fun being at a younger age, just going down the hill as fast as I can. So my family has kind of like just inherited that into me. When I was younger, we always went to Michigan because we have property up there. That's where we go skiing all the time. And so I just kind of taken it from there.
I started skiing about 6 years ago, and I started skiing because we went to Michigan a lot, and I had water skied growing up because I grew up on a lake, and I thought it would be fairly similar. It's really not. And I fell a lot, and I went down the bunny hill a lot at first, but then I accidentally went down a couple other slopes and fell. The last time I went skiing, Lizzie was with me, was trying to take a picture, and I slid on my ski and went down on my elbow and had frozen shoulder and was laid up for like a year. I couldn't raise my arm past here. And so you're never too late to start skiing, but be really careful.
I started skiing when I was 9, and we have property up in northern Michigan, and so one winter we went up to Michigan and we were like, oh, it'd be kind of fun to ski. So then we did. Definitely one of my most memorable moments while I was skiing was like when I was 9, the first time I went skiing, I was with my one of my older brothers, Christian. We went night skiing and there was only like a few slopes open, and they were like the harder ones and more advanced ones, and obviously I just started skiing so I couldn't really do that. But he took me up to the top of the slope and realized that it was like a black diamond, which is like really hard, you know, and I like had to go down, and I was like, I didn't know what I was doing, and so I fell at the top, and then my brother kept going down the hill, and then ski patrol had to like help me, and they had to take me down the mountain for me, and I had to like hold on to them.
Wrestling is both a physically and mentally taxing sport on the human body. With the addition of COVID, this challenging sport has become even harder to participate in. Unlike other sports, wrestlers are in closer contact with each other. We dug deeper into this mess of COVID, wrestling, and the problems these men and women have had to face this season.
It hasn't really bothered me as much. I mean, it just means that I get to go into sectionals healthier. I don't have to be beat up going into that time, so it doesn't really bother me.
Yeah, we're always wearing masks when we do weigh-ins now. And we're, like I said, we're just keeping people isolated. So that way, in case something happens, we don't have to take the whole team out. Everybody's separated. One thing that's different is we don't really, I've noticed I don't switch partners as much. It's usually just me and Lucas. We're just keeping ourselves contained and safe. So we're not, spreading everybody around. And we're just not traveling as much either, honestly.
I haven't really been active at home besides doing a little bit of cardio and stuff, like running a mile around the block, and that's about it. Well, you just gotta think ahead and can't really think about being quarantined. You just kinda gotta watch your weight and be ready for the next meet. Wearing a mask around school really helps, and wearing a mask when you go to like Walmart and stuff like that instead of disobeying and not wearing a mask really helps with the quarantine stuff.
I've ran a bunch. I did a lot of workouts at home. I made myself a new workout routine, and I've just been, whenever I get quarantined or whenever I have an off day, I just go hard.
All right, so the hardest part so far this year has been the consistency of who's going to be in the room. You got such different weight variations of kids, along with skill levels, and trying to plan a good workout or a consistent workout has been really difficult. It's hard to go really hard or really go a lot of live if you've got a big kid wrestling a real little kid, that kind of thing, trying to keep kids safe and healthy. That whole thing has made practicing extremely difficult as far as trying to have consistent workouts and one, just have enough kids in the room and then keeping them healthy, keeping them separated, things like that. It's been extremely complicated and stressful on some levels. So the big thing is we've gone, I would say, a lot less intense this year than I probably would have anticipated, kind of because of that. You know, we've got such big mismatches in the room with kids being out. So that's our main thing. And then we've kind of separated our room in groups so that, like, if one kid gets it, the whole team's not out.
Even with all the precautions this season that everyone on the team has taken, the match isn't quite over yet for these wrestlers.